When I began work on Rise, I guess after the success of Edge, a lot of people were saying to me there must be a bit of pressure, but there was really none. For some strange reason, I don't know, I felt really, not overconfident, but just confident with the new one, that I had a lot of ideas of where I wanted it to go. And also I had the confidence in Simon Hussey. Eventually they rise, yes they rise. When it came to doing the first album, I spoke to him at length and he said he was keen, as long as I was keen, because he didn't want to take on the project of recording my first solo album, which would be his first. And I guess he was a bit paranoid that if it failed, you know, everyone would turn to him and go, see, Daryl, it's because you've got a producer who had no credits. But I just felt, I mean, in here, I felt, and I think he knew that as well, Simon, that he could do it, and he did a fantastic job. Some things don't look to me like they used to be. No, when the days go by, I get a little closer to. When the days go by, a little bit closer to you. When the days go by, I get a little closer. I'm coming back to you. When I first started on the solo career, the first song that I actually received, or one of the first, was As the Days Go By, and it just had, as soon as I heard it, I rushed it down to Simon Hussey, the producer. I said, Simon, listen to this. And it was a demo from the guy that wrote it was Ian Thomas from Canada. And I said, have a listen to it. And it just, I mean, it had all the ingredients of saying what was on my mind for the last, I guess, 3 or 4 years previously, after I'd split up from, or the band had broken up, Sherbet. And it just said it all. I mean, it was sort of, especially my love of life just gets stronger as the days go by. I thought, this is it. Because what I was trying to do was come back as a solo entity, which is hard in any country, but having had a degree of success here in Australia earlier in my career, it was even harder, and I thought this song captures it, and no matter what happens, this is the right song to lead off, you know, as a first single or whatever for here in Australia, and it's still live, it proves me right, I think, and also that Ian Thomas is a great songwriter. Upon hearing As the Days, which I mentioned before, I was just ecstatic about it. And then All I Do, I thought, this song is, you know, it's unbelievable as well. It's got all that, the feel that I love. It's sort of, and it had a darkness about it, and which at that stage of my life, lyrically, it pertained to a relationship that I'd been going through and had been, I guess, a little bit tortured by, like most people. You get, I don't know, you get really frustrated. It's sort of, and you think that, you know, you can't sleep, you're restless at night, you're thinking about the other person, what they're doing, and all that. And All I Do summed that up for me. It's sort of, and always will, it's sort of, and that's why it was included, you know, on the album. think as a performer and singing and having learnt over the last 3 years, a completely different technique and attitude towards singing, and to a degree to audiences, of how to relate to them. It now, I feel as though I'm probably the right word would be relating better to an audience and to myself than I ever have done over the 20 years of singing, or 15, whatever it is. And it's an enjoyment that I think is growing for some reason. I think it's mainly because I'm being selfish with what I do. Whereas before, in the years leading up to this, I was probably more concerned with, God, I hope the audience appreciate this for what it is, and I hope I'm singing well and all that. But now I have the attitude of, well, it's up to me. You know, I've got to sing to a degree where I am so happy or so sad, whatever the song relates or means, that then it comes across. And I've learned that mainly through, I guess, the last, you know, the two albums, and also going to a singing teacher, Graham Clark, in Melbourne, Australia. And he taught me a lot, more so psychology, of, you know, simple questions like why? Why do you sing? You know, what do you want to do with singing? And how do you want an audience to react? What do you want them to see you as, and all that? And after 10 weeks of that, I walked away and thought, I've been doing it all wrong. I don't remember. I got no memory of anything at all. I don't remember, I don't recall. I got no memory of anything at all. Well, my inspiration comes from, I guess, the time that I spent away overseas last year, and just, I think, taking in a lot of what's happening around the world, and I guess in a way trying to not be philosophical, but just at least express some of my feelings that I've held back for a lot of years, and but just my feelings about, I guess, the pro-democracy and the things that happen in South Africa, here in Australia, and without becoming bombastic about it and trying to be political, but more of a social view. We will fly. The Horses is a song that I heard maybe a year ago off Ricky Lee Jones' album, and on hearing it for the first time I thought, God, what a great song. Just primarily on that was the first sense that I got, that it felt really good. And then upon listening to it, I thought it evoked in me the feeling that because I have a son, that I could relate to it in that respect. And then I actually tried to contact Ricky Lee Jones through her publishers and ask her what she'd actually written about, because I thought it might have been in some way really obscure. She may have written it with different meanings to the subject I thought it was. And anyway, she returned, you know, I found out that she'd actually written it specifically about that, of caring for a child, whether it be a mother, son relationship, or mother-daughter, or father-son in my case, and also on a broader aspect as well. So then after hearing that, I thought, right, you know, I want to do it. Not maybe as a single, but just an inclusion on the album, because it felt right, it felt in the right picture. Well, the process of writing Higher Than Hope stems from mainly Simon Hussey, who co-wrote it with myself. He initially had the idea upon watching a news broadcast of from South Africa, and of riots that had been occurring there, and he related it to me. And I went home, and upon the next day arriving at his place, before I got there, I pulled into a bookstore to buy him a book for his birthday, and I actually saw Nelson Mandela's biography called Higher Than Hope. And so I got to Simon's place, and he overnight had worked more on the lyric content of the song. And I said, well, I think I've got a title for it. And I said, you know, Higher Than Hope. And it just fitted in really well with of what he wanted to say lyrically, as well as what I thought of. And in essence, it's sort of like, not just wishing about, you know, like I wish that I won Lotto, or I wish that that would resolve itself, but going further than that, it's sort of like a, I guess, very idealistic in a sense.